Rosco, did you have a good time working with Duke Robillard and his band on these sessions?
Well, I could talk about the whole session forever.
Sure, yeah.
Because yep. it was just that great, man. You know, musicians just come right in and 10 minutes they got the song. 10 minutes on each song. The first day we recorded, which was the Monday, we did 4 songs. I'm complete. I don't mean started. But now, any other time, any other band, any other arranger, it would take 2 or 3 days to do 1 or 2 songs. But 3 days, we completed the whole 13 songs. I guess that's what made me fall in love with the band. I love the band. I'm not an old, beat-up old man, but I'm no teenager. But they made me feel like a teenager. I was jumping around just singing and playing the piano and having so much fun. I really enjoyed it. I did a thing for you called You Don't Care About Nothing. I just played the piano and sang. No drum, no bass, no nothing. Just now you're talking about a feeling, man. I got that was a joy to me.
Rosco, when you first went into the Sun Studios back in 1951, what are some of the memories that you have of being a teenager walking into a recording studio and making records for the first time?
You know, it never dawned on me what it was all about because I was having so much fun. It was just some more fun for me, you know, to be able to record. But the good part about it, Sam Phillips, man, he was one of the greatest producers I ever seen in my life, and he knew what he was looking for, no matter how long it took you to, you know, to get what he wanted, but he would always get what he wanted. When he say you got it, more or less you had it. So that was the most exciting part about it. But as far as me being excited about going into the studio recording, it wasn't there. Because, you know, as a kid, I always sang in the cotton field. People would, you know, when we get off the truck to go to the field, they would flock around me because they knew I was going to entertain them all. You know, I sang in the cotton field, of course. So I was already familiar with the audience. Even before I recorded, I was familiar with the audience because, you know, the people in the cotton fields.
What kind of material would you be singing in the cotton fields when you were a youngster like that?
I was singing a Nat King Cole song because he excited me, and Charles Brown, he excited me, and the other, Ivory Joe Hunter. You know, I went to his place down in Monroe, Louisiana, and when you go in his place, man, he had nothing but songs that he had, you know, started. And he would play them for you. If you stay there all day long, you listen to Ivory Joe Hunter all day long. And now I can understand why. Because he wanted to be Ivory Joe Hunter in no parts of any other act. I don't think he listened to other, you know, other artists. Because me, I don't listen to other artists. I listen to country and western and gospel and top 40. That's what I listen to.
Rosco, how did you come to Sam Phillips' attention in Memphis back in the early 50s, 51, I guess?
Yeah, well, the stage, see, I won first prize on the amateur show. This was a Wednesday night amateur show at the Palace Theater on Beale Street. Rufus Thomas, he was the MC. So at any rate, if you win first prize, that Thursday, you're on the radio. So this particular night, you know, my friends and I, we were Morgan Davis wine drinkers. So this particular night, we had no money for wine. So if you go on the stage, you're going to get X amount of dollars, you know, just by appearing there. So they boost me up to going up and do a show to get the wine money. So I go up and I win first prize. And the Thursday, I was on WDIA. I was interviewed by Nat D. Williams. And everybody sent cards and letters and called, and so that Friday I had to go back. And that Monday I had my own show. I had, you know, like 15 or 30 minutes. But anyway, I had a show there, and BB had a show, and let's see, who else? Earl Forrest, he also had a show, and Johnny Ace. So anyway, we was all on the radio, you know, it every day. So I don't know how this came about. The stage manager, he set up the meeting with Sam Phillips and me. That's how I went to Sun Records. So I was interviewed by Sam, and he had this song, Booted. Yeah, and so he asked me if I could do booty. So I told him, yeah. Well, I had the three-piece band. I had an alto player and a drummer and myself. I played the piano and sang. So we put the song together. And you know, he liked what we was doing. So he said, now you got to have another side. I said, well, I didn't realize that you had to have a two-sided record. He's putting out 45s. So at any rate, I wrote the other side. Bobby Bland, he was my chauffeur. So we was on our way to a gig one night, and Bobby started singing, it's 4 day in the morning, I got the early morning blues. I said, hey, man. I said, this thing is messed up. I said, I'm supposed to be your chauffeur. You know, he had this great voice, man. Well, he still does, I assume. But anyway, that night we got to the gig. I was pretty wild at that time. I was a dice shooter. I believe that you know, I could shoot dice. So anyway, Bobby Bland went to the stage that night. I went to the dice table. But now nobody bothered me all night long. And Bobby sang all night and nobody bothered me. So I said, hey, I said, this guy, you know, I knew he had it once I heard him. So anyway, I wrote the song, Love You Till the Day I Die. And that was on the other side of Booted. We thought that was going to be the song. See, Bobby and I did the song together. Now, we thought that was going to be the song, but instead, Booted took off.
Well, Booted was a big hit. That must have really changed your life and everything you were doing.
Well, what changed my life when our Shaw Agency, Billy Shaw from Shaw Agency, came from New York to Memphis to sign me up. Now, that's what changed my life. Because, you know, I had always worked around, you know, around Memphis. And my first job was at B.B. Beeman's Auditorium. I'll never forget it. In Atlanta, Georgia. Would you believe that I did three shows? I sang Booted twice on the first show, twice on the second show, and twice on the third show. And you know, I never sang Booted again. No, I don't sing it today. Because that took all the heart out of me, you know, doing the song that many times back to back. It made me hate the song. So anyway, I said, I'll write something else. So I wrote No More Dog and was next. And well, you know No More Dog, and it's going today. It's in a daytime soap in Hungary, Romeo and Juliet. Now I wonder what part what part of No More Dog and playing in Romeo and Juliet. But now that was the first song that I wrote. The song is selling today like it was recorded yesterday. So I'm proud of you because you gave me the opportunity to redo No More Doggin'.
Well, thank you, Rosco. No More Doggin', I think, is a great example of Rosco's rhythm. What do you think, looking back, are the components that kind of made all this come together for you to invent this new groove?
Well, I had a girlfriend, and I met another girl. So I took the other girl with me. And the original one, she came up, and that's where No More Doggin' came from. I told her, no more doggin' fooling around with you, because I had met this Peggy. Peggy was, you know, okay. So anyway, I wrote No More Doggin', and that was what inspired me. But, you know, back then, the guitar, it wasn't a popular instrument. See, the horn was the popular instrument. So Willie Weeks, he blew the tenor solo on No More Doggin'. But anyway, we knew nothing about guitar, so that was out. And knew very little about the bass. Before then, we recorded with no bass, no guitar, just the piano and the horns. You know, and the drums.
Rosco, it's been well documented that Rosco's rhythm was a big influence on the development of ska music, which, of course, became reggae music in Jamaica in the 50s. Did you know the effect that your music was having in Jamaica back then?
No. See, all this was hidden. What was happening here, they had to go to New Orleans to get my recordings. So what would happen, they would scratch the name off. So nobody would know who the artist was, you know, the buyer. Whoever bought the 45, he would take the name off. So nobody knew who the artist was. And I didn't find out about this until about 7-8 years ago. I found out that all this was derived from my Rosco's rhythm.
Have you been to Jamaica? Have you toured over there and worked with some of those players?
No, I took my own band over there. I went over there several times. But anyway, I was a big hit, you know, all over there. I played Malvern and also Barbados and Victoria and Rio de Janeiro. I worked all over there. I went down there three times. The last time I went down there, I had the record out called The Chicken. And my chicken passed away before I went down there. So I got another chicken. And you remember the dance, The Chicken?
Yeah.
So anyway, Butch, my chicken, passed away. And so I got another chicken. I tried to train another one, several others, but I was unsuccessful.
I've seen some of those photos of you on stage with the piano and the chicken right in front of you on the piano, too, I think. Is that?
Yeah. That was the movie called Rock Baby Rocket. He was a moneymaker. Yeah, I like the clubs because, see, during the intermission after the show, my valet would put a cup on his neck, you know, around his neck, and walking from table to table. And they would fill that cup up two or three times a night, you know, two or three times on doing each show. So he was the money maker.
Rosco, we were talking about No More Dog, and can you mention a couple of your other most successful tunes?
Let's see, No More Doggin', Just a Little Bit, and The Chicken, and Surely, and That's What You Do to Me. I could just go on and on, but these are the ones on the top of my head.
Some of those are classics, especially your song Just a Little Bit. That's been recorded over and over again, and I think you know, whenever you go see a blues band, chances are they'll know the song. Yeah,
yeah, they're going to play it.
Sure.
I think about 40 different acts recorded Just a Little Bit. Everybody that recorded, you know, like Jerry Butler, the Beatles, and Elvis Presley, and Little Milton, and just go on, so many different people, Roy Head, Jerry Butler, everybody got a big hit out of it.
Rosco, you must have had some wild times playing live music, and especially in the 50s with some of those rock and roll shows that had a lot of entertainers as part of the package. Did you have a lot of fun back then?
Man, it's like heaven. But the worst part about this whole scenario, you know, the segregation thing. You had to change clothes in your car or on the sidewalk or behind a blanket or something. No hotels, you know. You couldn't go in the hotels. That was the baddest part. And I was chased out of Lufkin, Texas. Not Lufkin, Corrigan. I go to this Dairy Queen. You know, you get a hamburger, cheeseburger. So I go there and I order a cheeseburger and a milkshake. Would you believe that these guys got out, when I came out of there, you know, they chased me out of there? They chased me out of that town, man. If I didn't have a good car, boy, I don't know what they would have done to me. But that was the bad part of the whole situation. But other than that, man, working, it was really fun. The feeling I get when I see an audience out there clapping their hands and having fun from my music, you could never imagine the feeling you get from that. The best feeling and the strangest feeling I ever got in my life, I worked at a place for retarded kids in Oslo, Norway. And this particular kid, he had his right hand up over his head. And he didn't like the seat he was sitting in. He got around where he could look right in my face. And before I finished my show, he was clapping his little hand, you know, dropping his little hand like that. Now, that was the weirdest feeling I ever had in my life. Especially when the counselor told me, he said, the kid slept with his hand up like that. So he never took his hand down. And he asked me, what did I do to make him take his little hand down like that? I said, man, I just sang from my heart. I said, evidently, the feeling I got, it was transposed to him. He got the same feeling. So that was one of the strangest, weirdest things. The worst gig I had, I work with three accordions. Can you imagine No More Dogging and booted with three accordions? No drum, no guitar, no nothing. Just three accordions. That was a miserable gig, man. But they had a great big old potbelly stove, red hot, you know. Three accordions. Three, not one, three. playing No More Doggin' and all the other things. So that was the worst gig I ever been on in my life. But God's been good to me, boy, I'm telling you. I mean, I'm God's pet. I know I'm his pet. If anybody's God's pet, I am. You know, because look what he did to me. He take care of me. Now he watch over me. And I'm able to see all my grandchildren. I gave the music up for it until my sons became men. I gave the music up for 20 years. I never stopped recording. I continued to record for my own label. And I continued to write. But as far as running up and down the highway, I said, I'm going to stand my sons up. So all my sons are men, and I'm back where God want me to be. He want me to be where I'm happy, and I'm happy in the music.
I wanted to ask you about that long time period when you stopped going on the road. Did you, was that when you moved to New York?
That's when I moved to New York. I came to New York and I went into business with some old guys, a cleaning business. I tried everything. I tried the police force, but my wife said she didn't want me to be a policeman. So I tried to be an electrician. And so then now I want to be a president. So I went to a school over on Chelsea, learn how to press clothes. But anyway, so I meet these guys and we get together and they open up the store. The store was already there, but the owner, he was selling it to one of the guys that I knew. He was selling it to his father, and they asked me if I wanted to be a part of it, so I said yes. So I stayed there for 17 years. And my wife passed away. When she passed away, my wife passed away in 84. Valentine's Day morning, that was my present. Valentine's Day morning, she passed away. And I told her on her dying bed, I said, don't you worry about the guys. I said, I'll be there for them. So they're men. I'm proud of them.
Well, Rosco, you sound like you got a real positive attitude. And I know you're a pretty healthy man. Every time I've seen you, you're looking good. And it's nice that after all the things that you've been through in the music industry, that you're back again, doing it once again and writing great material again.
Thank you. Well, I'm back to stay because the music is my life.